Ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure to introduce our speaker for this evening, Dr. Yiğit Akin, who is the Carter V. Findley Professor of Ottoman and Modern Turkish History at Ohio State University, whose research interests include the social and cultural history of the late Ottoman Empire and early Republican Turkey, with a particular focus on World War I and its aftermath. He's the author of Robust and Vigorous Children, Physical Education and Sports in Early Republican Turkey, and most recently, When the War Came Home, The Ottomans Great War and the Devastation of an Empire, which I think you can buy at our museum store, which is available online. Feel free to check that out. Now, that book examines the social and cultural dimensions of Ottoman society's catastrophic experience of World War I and analyzes the impact of the war on the empire's civilian population. He also co-edits the Ottoman Empire Middle East section of 1914-1918 online International Encyclopedia of the First World War. And I will pause for just a moment to say, if you have not looked at that resource, you must, particularly if you are a teacher. It is a spectacular, spectacular resource, that 1914-1918 online International Encyclopedia is not to be missed. And a kudos and a thank you for the work that you have been doing on that. And he is currently working on a book on the aftermath of the Ottoman Empire. Dr. Akin, we are truly thrilled to have you, welcome you back to the museum and memorial from our homes on this virtual stage on the centennial of the signing of the Treaty of Sèvres, which in brief we'll be learning about, but it certainly is deeply impactful treaty on the making of the modern Middle East. With that, this virtual stage is yours.
Indeed. Thank you so much, Laura. Thanks so much, Camille, for organizing this. I mean, I wish we could have this, we could make this in your beautiful Kansas City, because I still haven't found my favorite barbecue joint as we were talking before the for lecture. So I haven't come across two people offering, suggesting the same place. So I am trying over and over again. Hopefully next time, I'll find one.
And if you're here in Zoom or Facebook Live and you are in Kansas City and you do have a suggestion, we'll be free to take those too.
Oh, yeah. I would love that. I'm sure there will be so many suggestions again. I would love to try any one of them. Okay, thank you so much. I mean, it's great to be with you, even though, you know, virtually this time, it's great to be with you. I am addressing you from a bare office because this is the very first time that I use this office. I actually picked this office today. I got the keys today, but you know, things can be done. Let me share my screen with you and let's begin our discussion. So tonight, as you know, tonight I would like to talk about a very important treaty, a peace treaty, Treaty of Sèvres, which was signed 100 years ago today, around this time, in the afternoon, Paris time, around this time, between the Ottoman Empire and their wartime enemies, the Allied powers. So I divided my lecture into three subsections. First of all, I would like to start with a background. So backgrounds are important. The context is important for historians, as you know, to be able to understand the importance of this crucial moment in the broader history of the Ottoman Empire and the Middle East. So then I will turn my attention to the treaty itself and discuss its terms and its impact. And then finally, I would like to talk about the afterlife of the treaty. Believe it or not, the treaty has a very vibrant afterlife. So let's start with a brief definition, a description. Treaty of Sèvres is actually the fifth and the last of all wartime treaties that were signed between the vanquished, between the losers of the First World War, and the winners, between the Central Powers and the Allied Powers. Treaty of Sèvres was signed, as I said, in August 1920. It officially ended the hostilities between the Ottoman Empire on the one hand, and their wartime enemies, the Allied powers, on the other hand. So the hostilities, of course, ended with an armistice, but technically, before signing the peace treaty, these two bodies were still in war, still in conflict. So the August 1920 formalized the end of the hostilities and the peace. But to be able to understand, as I said, the moment better, we first have to turn our attention to the Ottomans' Great War experience, because all of these treaties, as you know very well, were signed in the aftermath of the Great War. So for the Ottoman people, the 10 long years between 1912 and 1922 were a period of crisis shaped by successive conflicts. First, the Balkan Wars, 1912-1913, the World War I, 1914-1918, and finally, the Turkish War of Independence, as we'll discuss, 1919-1922, literally exhausted the empire's human capital, leaving millions of people dead, wounded, and captive. And millions more widowed, orphaned, and bereaved. World War I, however, had been fought on a much larger scale than the conflicts that preceded and succeeded it. It was fought on a much larger scale than the Balkan Wars and the Turkish War of Independence. The Great War spanned 4 years for the Ottoman Empire, from October 1914 to October 1918. The hope of regaining lost territories in the previous decades and achieving full economic and political independence drove the Ottoman political policymakers into the war. More importantly, however, they were the realization by the government that the war would eventually extend to the Ottoman Empire, and that the empire could not survive such a massive conflict on its own, draw them into a search for an alliance with one of the power blocks in Europe. While one of them, the Entente, or the Allied powers, rejected them, the Central powers accepted them. So as a result, the Ottomans signed a secret treaty of alliance with Germany on August 2nd, 1914, and the same day declared a massive general mobilization, seferberlik in Turkish, in Arabic, in other languages of the region. After 3 months of armed neutrality, the Ottomans entered war on the side of the Central powers. Central powers were consisted of, so this is the this is Europe in 1914, you know, slightly misleading, but Central powers at the beginning were composed of course, Germany, Austria-Hungary, and the little Ottoman Empire, as you see here. After October 1915, with the joining of Bulgaria into the alliance, they became an alliance of four, the Central powers. So, over the next 4 years, the Ottomans would fight a multi-front war against the Allies. They confronted Russians in the Caucasus and Eastern Anatolia. You see here the famous Sèvres campaign. They fought against, of course, British, French, and the others in a famous Gallipoli campaign. They fought against the British in Palestine and the Suez Canal zone, again the British in modern day Iraq, in Mesopotamia. They conducted operations in Persia. The Ottoman forces also fought sole conflict in the European theaters of war, basically helping their wartime allies of Austria, Hungary, and Germany. Macedonia, and in Galicia. So this was an extremely difficult process for the Ottomans. To the surprise of both its allies and its enemies, the Ottoman army proved to be more resilient than many had expected. Although its size and strength diminished significantly over the 4 years of 4 years due to both high casualty and desertion rates, the Imperial Army remained at war until the final month of the conflict. They signed actually the armistice only 11 days before the Germans signed. Throughout the war, the Ottoman forces tied down large enemy contingents in the Middle East, diverting them from the European theaters of war. And we are talking about hundreds of thousands of British and French soldiers who had to be maintained in the Middle East to keep the Ottoman Empire in check. The Ottomans also fought successful battles and scored remarkable victories, such as the famous defense of the Dardanelles, the Gallipoli campaign in 1915, and the siege of Kut al-Amara in Iraq today, and the surrender of a 13,000 strong British Indian division in 1916. This was the largest before the British surrender in Singapore in 1942. So these victories, however, were not sufficient to win the war for the Ottomans. World War I, as you see in this table, took a very heavy toll on the Ottomans in terms of human and material losses. The beginning of the Great War, the population of the Ottoman Empire were estimated by historians at about 19, 20 million in its core provinces. So out of that 19, 20 million, the Ottomans managed to mobilize on a short notice hundreds of thousands of soldiers, and over the war, over the conflict, almost maybe 2.9, 3 million civilians. Of this massive force, the empire would suffer some 750,000 fatalities. Another 750,000 soldiers were wounded, some of them, as you saw in this table, permanently wounded. And some 250,000 ended up in foreign captivity. This gigantic loss of human capital had enormous social, economic, demographic, cultural, as well as political consequences for the Ottoman home front population, as well as for the states established in the region following the demise of the Ottoman Empire. By the time the guns fell silent in October 1918, the Ottoman society had been deeply traumatized by the high number of casualties, by a devastated economic infrastructure, a truly devastated economic infrastructure, as I try to explain, discuss in my book, voluntary and involuntary displacement, ethnic cleansing, and political instability. Most of the empire's Arab provinces, comprising contemporary Syria, Iraq, Jordan, Israel, and Palestine, came under the occupation of the Allies. So as you see here in this map. Mostly the British forces, however. In November 1918, the Allied warships crossed the straits, and the Allied troops then entered the imperial capital, Istanbul or Constantinople, and established a de facto occupation regime, which they turned into official occupation regime in March 1920. So the capital was occupied since November 1918, but it was de facto occupation. The jure official occupation started in March 1920. So the Treaty of Sèvres was signed under these conditions of occupation, of course. The end of the war plunged the empire, Ottoman Empire, into a painful period of instability. The collapse of the wartime, ruthless wartime regime, the arrival of the Entente troops, the global spread of Wilsonian promise of self-determination, national self-determination, which I actually discuss, a little advertisement here, which I discuss in a previous symposium, 2019 symposium of World War I Museum, which you can find on YouTube, I believe, which of course had, many fantastic lectures. I wouldn't say mine was that fantastic, but if you want to learn more about the immediate post-war period in the Ottoman Empire, I would recommend that video and the Ottomans Wilsonian moment. So the spread of the nation, Wilsonian national self-determination politically energized Ottoman minorities as never before. So this makes this period, the short period actually between 1919 and 1922, the short 4 years, truly unique in the long Ottoman history. Each ethno-religious community of the empire ambitiously took on aspirations of self-determination. A series of short-lived, mostly ineffectual, mostly unstable Ottoman governments struggled to navigate this increasingly complex socio-political landscape but they couldn't manage it. All the while, they sought to develop a defensive strategy to convince the peacemakers convened in Paris, famous Paris Peace Conference, to salvage at least the unoccupied parts of the empire. For many Ottoman Greeks, self-determination meant union with Greece, first and foremost. So, as you see here. At the peace conference, the legendary Greek prime minister, legendary for the foreign observers and his Greek followers, of course, Greek prime minister Eleftherios Venizelos, here you see on this famous poster, resorted to historical, ethnographic, economic arguments, but most importantly, again, the Wilsonian rhetoric of self-determination to make territorial claims on the Western Anatolian coastland. Here you see on this map, where the Ottoman Turks, as you see these parts all the way down, here it's, this is a modest description often, where the Ottoman Greeks constituted a sizable minority, not the majority, a sizable minority. Eventually, Venizelos, as we'll discuss shortly, Venizelos would manage to charm the peacemakers in Paris into granting Greece a zone of occupation around Smyrna, Izmir. Meanwhile, other non-Muslim minority group, ethno religious minority of the Ottoman Empire, Armenians, aimed to establish, as you see here, an enlarged independent Armenia, the boundaries of which would extend well into Central Anatolia and Eastern Anatolia, where Armenians lived historically. With the end of the war, thousands of survivors of the Armenian genocide were returning to their towns and villages in the Ottoman Empire to reclaim their properties and establish their lives that had been destroyed. So all of these developments that were happening above at the political level and that were happening at the everyday level triggered deep anxiety amongst the Ottoman Turks, who constituted the empire's demographic majority. Unlike the Ottoman minorities, Turks knew that they could count on very few supporters in Paris. The Allied statesmen were angry at the Ottomans for entering the war unnecessarily and unjustifiably. In their minds, Lloyd George, for example, famously was very angry about the Ottomans. The war would have ended much earlier had the Ottoman Empire remained neutral. This is why they were extremely angry at the Ottomans and blaming them for costing hundreds of thousands of casualties, extra casualties. But the peacemakers were also furious at the Ottomans for making for their wartime treatment of non-Muslim minorities, particularly the Armenians, the famous Armenian genocide. For the peacemakers, the long record of Ottoman misgovernment, culminating in the wartime massacres, demonstrated the Ottoman Turks' incapacity to administer a multi-ethnic, multi-religious population. Although they sensed the intense anger and, you know, contempt, even contempt, directed towards them, the Ottomans still harbored hope that a fundamentally reformed new international system, based, of course, on Wilsonian principles of self-determination and the consent of the governed, would accord them a dignified place in the new post-war order. Thus, the Ottoman Turks pinned their hopes to of preserving the empire, empire's territorial integrity, to be more accurate, on these principles laid out by Wilson, President Wilson himself. After all, it was Wilson who had promised them such dignity in the 12th of his famous 14 points. So the 12th point was directly related to the Ottoman Empire. The Turkish portions of the present Ottoman Empire should be assured secure sovereignty, but the other nationalities which are now under Turkish rule should be assured an undoubted security of life and an absolutely unmolested opportunity of autonomous development. So for the Ottoman Turks, the 12th point indisputably recognized Turkish sovereignty, at least in Anatolia, Asia Minor, and Thrace, and demonstrated Wilson's personal commitment to the integrity of the Ottoman Empire, at least the Turkish portions of the Ottoman Empire. Yet, the Ottoman Turks would soon learn their hopes and expectations would not be fulfilled. To their great dismay, the conference, the peacemakers in Paris, sanctioned the Greek occupation of Western Anatolia in May 1990. The crucial, arguably the most important turning point of the post-war Ottoman Empire, post-war Ottoman history. So this represented a, you know, as I said, a dramatic turning point in the twilight years of the empire. The conference's approval of the Greek Greek occupation confirmed the Ottomans' worst fears that the peacemakers had decided to partition the empire, including its Turkish portions. The occupation expectedly inflamed Ottoman public opinion as never before, I would say, leading to a nationwide wave of protest. It was seen as a clear violation, which is actually a clear violation, of the principle of self-determination and was protested mostly on that basis. The Greek occupation also precipitated a resistance movement in Anatolia, in the interior of Anatolia, away from the Ottoman government under Allied occupation of the capital. This resistant movement was already developing very slowly, very unorganizedly. But you know, after the occupation of Smyrna, Izmir, the resistant movement slowly and gradually gained a more organized, more disciplined posture under the charismatic leadership of famous Mustafa Kemal Pasha, who happened to be the first president, who will be the first president of the Turkish Republic as well. As we'll discuss. So, a long introduction here, almost 20 minutes. So when I do this, students hate that, of course, but it was absolutely crucial for us to understand why this moment was so crucial, why it's so important. Who were the main actors? Who were, you know, what were the main conditions here? We're talking, we talk about so many different political and social developments here, and without them, discussing exclusively the Treaty of Sèvres would be missing, I believe. Treaty of Sèvres was imposed upon the Ottoman Empire under these circumstances. The capital under occupation, the government, the Sultan, basically under the guise of the occupying powers, the allied powers, a resistance movement was developing in Anatolia and getting increasingly disciplined and organized posture. Different parts of the empire were occupied by Greeks, Italians landed forces in southwestern Anatolia, there were British, there were French, there were many, many Americans were traveling in the former Ottoman lands. So it's a really complicated. Armenian refugees and the survivors of the genocide were returning. So all kind of, you know, developments, sociopolitical developments that, you know, that would be really critical for us to understand what was happening in this moment. So the Treaty of Sèvres, as I said, was imposed upon the Ottoman Empire under these circumstances. It took more than a year and a half, almost 20 months, for the Allies to finalize their negotiations among themselves. So negotiations about how to partition the Ottoman Empire, of course, and draft a peace treaty for the Ottomans. This is why it's the last treaty, last peace treaty, because the negotiations among them lasted so long. The treaty was signed exactly 100 years ago today, August 10th, 1920, in Sèvres, a southwestern suburb of Paris, at a famous, if not the most famous, porcelain factory of Europe. So the Sèvres porcelains are, you know, world famous. The signatories of the treaty included Britain, France, Italy, Japan, Belgium, Greece, Poland, Portugal, Czechoslovakia, Yugoslavia, Hijaz, as one more, Armenia, of course, on one side, and the Ottoman Empire, obviously, on the other hand. On the parts of the Ottomans, the treaty was signed by a delegation formed and sent by the government of Damat Ferit Pasha. So this is the famous picture of the Ottoman delegation. Here they were on the deck of an allied warship. So the Grand Vizier here, second from the left, and the three other members of the delegation, which would sign the treaty, the infamous Treaty of Sèvres. So this delegation signed the treaty, and here the famous pictures, you know, that were taken during the moment of signing the treaty, all other representatives of the nations. So here the Ottoman representatives, the moment when the Ottoman representatives were signing the treaty 100 years ago today. So here's an interesting detail for you. How about that elaborate porcelain on the desk? This is a very elaborate writing set, which of course was manufactured in this famous porcelain factory. And it was designed and produced, manufactured specifically for Kaiser Wilhelm II, the German German Kaiser. But you know, because of the start of the war, it was not sent. But you know, as a sign of humiliation, you know, peace treaties were all full of these kind of symbolic, you know, gestures and anti-gestures. You know, forcing Germany to sign the treaty in the Hall of Mirrors or those kind of things. So this is. This was brought, this writing set was brought here intentionally, of course, and was made to use to sign this treaty, the peace treaty of the Ottomans. So the Treaty of Sèvres, it was an extremely detailed technical document, which consisted of 13 sections. Here, a good summary, 13 sections and 433 articles prepared by five separate special committees formed during the peace conference. I wouldn't recommend that you read the treaty, at least not from cover to cover. It's, you know, occasionally extremely deadly boring. The language is extremely technical, you know, intentionally so, but it is, of course, an extremely important historical document. The most well-known and the most infuriating articles of the treaty were the ones that were related to the Ottoman territories, the partitioning of the Ottoman territories, infuriating for the Ottoman Turks, of course. The treaty, first of all, severed the connection, the historic connection between the Turkish and non-Turkish regions of the Ottoman Empire. This is sometimes forgotten. This is sometimes either not mentioned when discussed the Treaty of Sèvres, or you know, discussed in the margins. But this is, if you ask me, this is one of the most important historical legacies of the Treaty of Sèvres. So officially, the Ottoman Empire, the Turkish and non-Turkish sections of the Ottoman Empire, territories of the Ottoman Empire, were severed from one another. Here I mean mostly the Arab provinces of the empire, of course. These provinces were under the Ottoman suzerainty for more than 400 years by now, by 1920. The Treaty of Sèvres formalized the Ottoman surrender of these provinces to Britain and France, or to more accurately, to British and the French empires, not as colonies though, but under a specific administrative structure, the mandates, League of Nations mandates. So modern day, the regions, if you look at the Fertile Crescent here on the right map, this comparison, I love this comparison. So the Ottoman Empire in 1914, see, still, you know, lost many provinces, but still a huge empire, which was occupying the entire Arab Middle East, almost the entire Arab Middle East, with the exception of North Africa, of course. But by 1920, it was severed from, it was divided into different sections. So League of Nations mandates meant that these territories would be entrusted by the League of Nations, which itself was a legacy of World War One, to more developed nations to prepare the people of these areas to stand independently. Until that day, who would decide that? Of course, those are the mandatory nations. So Syria and Lebanon became a French mandate. Palestine, including Jordan, today's Jordan, became a British mandate. And three Ottoman provinces, Baghdad, Basra, and Mosul, were combined and made a different British mandate, which eventually meant the mandate of Mesopotamia, which eventually became Iraq. So the Treaty of Sèvres actually formalized that division, affirmed that division, which was, you know, a legacy that's still with us today, which we'll discuss shortly. Second, the second important territorial consequence of the Treaty of Sèvres, to the great dismay of the Ottoman Turks, to the great dismay of the Ottoman Turks, the treaty put Izmir, Smyrna, in the western Anatolian coast, which happened to be my hometown as well, and which I would say, without hesitation, the most beautiful city of Turkey, right here, the second most important port town, by the way, of the empire, by 1920, and the surrounding regions to Greece. So, this region, including Izmir, was put under Greek administration with a plebiscite to be held after 5 years to decide if the region should be annexed permanently to Greece. In addition to that important Western Anatolian coastal area, Thrace here in northwestern Turkey, was also given almost completely to Greece as well. Third, the Treaty of Sèvres recognized special regions of interest for Italy and France in southern and southwestern Anatolia. Here you see the French region of interest and the Italian area of interest. Now, technically, these were parts of a different treaty, the tripartite agreement signed between British, French, and Italians the same day, basically to talk about these details of how to partition, how to create these special regions of interest. But this is what it is. Fourth, Istanbul, the imperial capital, right here, imperial capital, would remain as the seat of the Ottoman government and the caliphate, but it would become an international city. So international cities, several of them, were created by other treaties. So Istanbul was one of them, with free navigation through the straits. The whole straits area, so that big region actually, would be administered by an international commission. And if this is not enough, Istanbul could be removed from the Ottoman administration if the Ottoman government infringed on minority rights. So there is that kind of a threat installed in the treaty as well. Fifth, the Ottoman Empire was to accept President Wilson's decision. So Wilson was duty to draw that map as to the border between the empire and an independent Armenia with access to the sea. Wilson finally drew such a map in November 1920. And here on the eastern side, as you see, in a significantly enlarged independent Armenia, the region given to Armenia, which included, of course, many parts which were not part of the historic homelands of Armenians. Sixth, the treaty entitled the Kurds to autonomy in southeastern Anatolia, much more vaguely, much more elusively than the Armenians. Kurds were promised autonomy first, And in a separate clause, separate article, they were promised, they were given the right to apply to right of petition, to apply to the League of Nations for an independent Kurdish state. So independence was not exclusively promised them in the Treaty of Sèvres. Sometimes that's also a mistake that was commonly done when talking about. So, but you know, it basically set the timeline, set the timetable for an independent, for from autonomy to an independent Kurdistan, a Kurdish state. So many Kurds actually did not buy this, approached the treaty with skepticism, and you know, during War of Independence, supported the nationalist, Turkish nationalist forces. So these are the six most important territorial consequences of the Treaty of Versailles, all of which were deeply infuriating for the Ottoman Turks. So the empire, the treaty basically butchered the remaining territories of the empire, and leaving to the Turks this green region in central and northern Anatolia, which nobody else wanted. So these are the famous territorial clauses. The territory, the treaty's non-territorial clauses were equally infuriating for the Ottoman Turks. For instance, the much-hated capitulations were to be restored. Capitulations were a series of historic treaty agreements between the Ottoman Empire and several European states that conferred extraterritorial status to the subjects of those European states and gave them a number of judicial, fiscal, economic privileges, including, for example, exemption from the income tax, the right to trial in mixed courts, and legal protection of consulate, legal protection by consulates. So capitulations were much were deeply hated by the Ottoman Turks, Ottoman Muslims in general, from the late 19th century on. And at the beginning of World War I, when the Ottoman, you know, shortly after the Ottomans declared mobilization, the capitulations were canceled unilaterally by the government, by the Committee of Union and Progress government, to a great fanfare. So this was celebrated as the rebirth of the Ottoman Empire. You know, finally the Ottomans are breaking the chains that were holding them back politically and economically. Now those much hated capitulations were restored, were brought back to the Ottoman Empire. In addition, an allied financial commission would be established, which would oversee the state budget, taxes, loans, in effect, control, would have almost exclusive control of Ottoman finances. The Ottoman land forces were to be reduced to 50,700 men, most of them would be gendarmes. There would be no regular army, no navy, no tanks, no heavy artillery, no airplanes, no battleships, nothing. So as you see, the treaty was exceedingly punitive, exceedingly harsh. And with all these clauses that I discussed in the last 10 minutes or so, the Treaty of Sèvres expectedly was deeply hated by many Ottoman Muslims, Ottoman Turks, or Ottoman Muslims also, from the very beginning. The Grand National Assembly, the parliament that was convened by the resistance movement, you remember the resistance movement that I mentioned at the beginning, was organizing under the leadership of Mustafa Kemal Pasha, a decorated hero of World War I and the hero of Gallipoli campaign. So he was now firmly on the saddle, and the parliament that was established, that was convened by the resistance movement in April 1920, without hesitation, immediately rejected the treaty and never ratified it. So the Treaty of Sèvres was actually never ratified in the Ottoman Empire. The Ottoman parliament did not exist at the time. It was disbanded, it was dissolved after the occupation. And the Grand National Assembly never ratified it. So the parliament also declared the Ottoman delegates who signed the treaty as the traitors to the nation. Following the Turkish victory of the War of Independence, they were included, the signers of the treaty, included in the list of 150 persona non grata, unwanted persons, and had to leave Turkey in late 1922. In 1927, so see the parliament doesn't forget, in 1927, after the establishment, 4 years after the establishment of the Turkish Republic, the signatories were stripped of their citizenship by the Grand National Assembly. By the time the treaty was signed in August 1920, the nationalists, the resistance movement, the nationalists had managed to organize a successful resistance movement in Anatolia through skillful diplomacy, close collaboration with non-Western powers, most notably the Bolsheviks, who were suffering from similar treatments at the hands of the Western powers, the extensive use of coercion and intensive propaganda effort. So over the next 2 years, the nationalists, or the nation's resistance movement to be more accurate, fought a successful war of liberation against the occupying Greek army. By that time, the Greek army was expanding and occupying areas much beyond that the Treaty of Sèvres granted them. So, but as a result of, you know, two and a half years of bloody war between the Turks, the resistant, Turkish resistance movement, and occupying Greek army, Turks emerged out of this war victorious. As a result, Turks became the only people among the defeated belligerents of World War I, who could force a renegotiation of the punitive peace treaty that was imposed upon them. So which made the Turks, the Ottoman Turks, unique examples. Germans couldn't do that, Austrians couldn't do that, Hungarians couldn't do, Bulgarians couldn't do that. So the Turks, as a result of their resistance, as a result of the resistance from very beginning to the Treaty of Sèvres, and as a result of a successful war of independence, could manage to force a renegotiation of this punitive, exceedingly punitive treaty. So Treaty of Lausanne, which was signed in July 1923, hopefully in 3 years, we can have a conversation in Kansas City this time, trying several other barbecue joints, hopefully finding my favorite. Officially, Treaty of Lausanne, which was signed in July 1923, officially recognized Turkish Republic, the boundaries, the existence, the boundaries of Turkish Republic, and negated the clauses of the Treaty of Sèvres pertaining to Anatolia. So that last part is important, which we'll discuss shortly, pertaining to Anatolia. In that sense, it was a stunning reversal of the Sèvres, of Treaty of Sèvres. Here you see, in, you know, 1920s, 1930s, during the formative years of the Turkish nationalism, Treaty of Sèvres and its negation by the Treaty of Lausanne occupied a central place in Turkish propaganda, Turkish nationalist propaganda. Here you see, most of you probably cannot understand the caption here. So İsmet Paşa, this is the close collaborator of Mustafa Kemal Paşa, and the chief negotiator during the chief negotiator of the Treaty of Lausanne. So the iron hand of İsmet Paşa signed the Treaty of Lausanne like this. And of course, this is, you know, the emerging Turkish nation represented, of course, as a woman, breaking the porcelain, the vase of Sèvres. So that porcelain, the concept of porcelain comes over and over again. Today it's forgotten, but it was always there, you know, for the people who remember, who lived through this period. So, so Turks, as a result of their renegotiation, managed to retain all of Anatolia, as well as Istanbul, as well as Thrace, as well as Istanbul and the Straits, was relieved of reparations, and probably more importantly, the hated capitulations. So they from very early on during the Lausanne negotiations, they said, you know, they don't want the capitulations. There is no for them. And accepted far weaker minority clauses that were imposed on other newly established states in Eastern Europe. So far, so good. However, the treaty's provisions Remember what I said about pertaining to Anatolia? So the Turks, as a result of their successful war of independence, could overturn the Treaty of Sèvres, or the clauses of the Treaty of Sèvres pertaining to Anatolia. However, the treaty's provisions on Arab lands were not overturned by Lausanne. So Lausanne was exclusively Turkish, including the minorities. Document about Turks, the state system imposed on the Arab world, confirmed by the Treaty of Sèvres, was to survive and endure down to the present day. So, however, that system was shaped by imperial ambitions rather than a process of self-determination. So in that sense, all of these mandate areas, mandate regions, in the aftermath, during or in the aftermath of World War II, emerge as independent nations, the boundaries of which, the divisions of which, were actually determined by the negotiations among imperial forces. So, not by the people's own will. In that sense, the Treaty of Sèvres' impact on the Arab lands still continues. So it was, as a result, one of the most important documents that contributed to the making of the modern Middle East. Does that mean that it doesn't have any impact, any legacy in Turkey? The answer is a big no. Although the Treaty of Sèvres was overturned by the Turkish nationalists, Turkish nationalist movement, and never ratified, never implemented in Anatolia and Thrace, its impact also continues in Turkey. Interestingly, and fantastically for social scientists. From early on, but especially in the last quarter of the 20th century, the Treaty of Sèvres has fueled a form of nationalist paranoia, sometimes called by scholars as the Sèvres syndrome. The Treaty of Sèvres, in that regard, have been perceived as a strong evidence, unmistakable evidence, that outside forces, especially the West, because all of them, the signatories were Western powers, most of them at least, has always had an intention to weaken, exploit, and divide Turkey. The country, according to that perception, is encircled by external enemies, as evidenced by the Treaty of Sèvres, attempting to destroy it. So here is an interesting, caricature. It's in Turkish, of course, in 1991, by one of the nationalistically inclined artists of the time. Seriously, again, a vase, as in a porcelain, the Treaty of the vase of Sèvres. As you see, so the parts of these structures from top to down, military limitations, agency, Armenia, Kurdistan, Constantinople, borders, economic limitations, and of course, who is constructing the ways, the West, and of course, the United States. So, Treaty of Sèvres, in that sense, was regarded as a strong evidence that there was a conspiracy, that Western nations, Western, at least the policymakers of Western nations, were in a constant conspiracy to divide, to weaken Turkey. And the Treaty of Sèvres is the best evidence for that. Like in all conspiracy theories, all similar conspiracy theories, these external enemies have, of course, their internal collaborators, depending who, similarly, help them to weaken and divide the nation. Depending on the political context, the political ones change frequently in Turkey. Depending on the political context, these internal collaborators, according to this perception, could be the Kurds, major minority, the leftists, the Alawites and other minorities, or simply anyone who thinks and behaves outside the norms of imposed by the state and its official ideology. So the Treaty of Sèvres did not have a political or juridical impact on Turkey. It was never implemented in Turkey, as we said, it was never ratified in Turkey. Nevertheless, as a useful discursive tool to denigrate and intimidate, it is still with us, very much alive and well. Actually, the most alive of all post-World War I treaties. Thank you. Laura gave me 40 minutes, but you know, I've been talking about 47 minutes now. The students would have killed me, of course.
That actually holds true of any of our teacher workshops, like the teachers, if it's a minute until, and I say this as a former classroom teacher, there are no questions because any good educator knows you never go over time. And yet, that is not necessarily true in public programs. We do have a little bit of time left. I'm going to ask you just a couple of fast questions. And then if you're open to it, we might stop the recording and ask just a few more. The first, I think, might actually be from a teacher because this is one of the questions that we do often get in those that are more specifically based towards teachers. By the way, if you are one and joining us this evening, check out our offerings at theworldwar.org/online. Go to our webinars. We offer an hour of PD certification with some great resources. There's a wide variety of things coming up, including a conversation about World War I and Tolkien. But this question from Michael Williams, is there any way to receive a copy of the PowerPoint?
Okay, email me.
There you go, Michael. We have a ton of questions. Thank you all so much, and more are coming in here on Facebook as well.
I don't have a Facebook account, but you know.
Right, that's okay, I'll ask you the questions. So from Stephen Slaughter, if the Ottomans had stayed neutral, how long do you think they would have kept hold of its non-Turkish possessions? And how often are you asked this hypothetical question?
Well, I mean, I've been asked a lot. I mean, it depends. So Turks don't like asking questions. So in Turkey, before I go to Turkey, I don't want to tell that I'm an historian in a cab or in a barbershop or something like that, because whenever you said, you'll begin to hear a history lesson, still lecture. So as a result, but in the States, yeah, people do ask, students do ask that question. To be honest, I don't think that the Ottomans, the Unionist perception was pretty correct at the time. The war would inevitably, and probably soon, would spread to the Ottoman lands. So, because, you know, it was partly fought over the Ottoman possessions. It's difficult to, you know, answer with a sharp, clear date, but maybe they could have extended had they not signed that treaty, Treaty of Alliance, maybe until December, late December 1914, but I don't really see, you know, that because as the war became intensified in Europe, as the Germans and Russians became, you know, involved in a deeply fight in Eastern Europe, they would look for ways to cross over the Ottoman territories. So that was, you know, to me, it was kind of impossible thing to keep the Ottoman Empire out of the war. Well, they didn't try anyway, but, you know, could have been extended a little bit, but not too much. If that answers this question, it's hypothetical, of course.
Right. I think any answer you choose to give to a hypothetical question is probably the right answer. Stephen, you may not agree with me,
but I don't know
whether you are here and you are asking the questions. From Joseph Newkirk, it is well documented that President Wilson's statements were often misconstrued by translators. How much did the states involved in the treaty rely on linguistic interpreters? And how reliable, in your opinion, were they in expressing the intent and the meaning of the speaker of the original language?
Well, I mean, that's, of course, a commonly discussed issue. You know, sometimes, beyond that, yeah, there are those kind of translation mistakes during the peace conference. There are misunderstandings, of course. You know, all of them are ambitious, extremely ambitious statesmen, and who really were experiencing difficulties before their home front populations. They were really grilled by their home front, by the population to get most out of this peace conference. So their intention occasionally was also to misunderstand to you know, misunderstand these. When it comes to the Ottoman question, I don't think that that Wilson had much love for the Ottomans. So he, from early on, as a Gladstonian, you know, as someone who followed the British Gladstonian tradition, he pretty much hated the Ottomans from very early on. If I may, I can recommend a great new book by Larry Wolf of NYU, who I cannot recall the exact name of the book, but Wilson, it came out with Stanford University Press. You'll find it. It's Wilson's Imagination of Eastern Europe. It's slightly misleading because the first chapter talks about the Ottoman, you know, Wilson's perception of, you know, early Ottoman Empire. Well, you know, I'm writing an article. I'm about to finish. I'm writing an article. How can we explain, the question is this, how can we explain, if there are so many, there weren't many people who liked the Ottomans among them, you know, as they explain. How come this, you know, clause, you know, the 12 point of the 14 points were, you know, somewhat generous to the Ottomans? So this is pretty much generous. So how can we explain that? So I'm, you know, I thought about this pretty much. So this is not exactly an answer to your question, but, you know, when it comes to the Ottoman question, there wasn't much misconception. So the Ottomans were pretty much, because of the reasons that I said at the beginning, were pretty much and universally hated by the allied statesmen. This didn't mean that they constituted a uniform front against the Ottomans, because, you know, Italians and the Greeks would like to get the same part, the same parts of the Ottoman Empire, the western and southwestern parts. So they had their own ambitions. They, you know, sometimes left the table, famously, Orlando, and, you know, conflicted among themselves. You know, as I said, you know, why was this treaty signed so late? Because their imperial ambitions cannot be settled. So they discussed, redraw, and finally reached their conclusion. By the way, you know, those negotiations were going on since 1915, 1916. So that was a long, discussion. Mm-hmm. I know it's not an exact answer to your question, but, you know.
Now, tying into that, and actually we had several people who asked this question, in addition to what you just mentioned about Allied perceptions of Ottomans, is there anything else that you would add to the question of why the Ottomans did not choose to ally with the Allied powers?
Well, they chose. They did pretty much everything in their capacity to establish, to enter an alliance, or, you know, an alliance, a treaty of alliance with, you know, with Great Britain. They would love that. With France, even with Russia, their arch enemy of Russia, before the war in June 1914. We don't know how sincerely, but still, the Ottoman Prime Minister, Talat Pasha, at the same time, sent some representatives to the Russians. So, you know, why not are we building an, you know, a front, entering a treaty of, you know, alliance? So they tried pretty much everything in their capacity to, first of all, you know, not to survive this war. They are pretty sure that they cannot survive this war by themselves. Because they experienced the Balkan Wars before. And they got their lessons that the Ottoman army was in a dismal situation. They couldn't survive such a small war. They cannot survive much by themselves. But, you know, they were not fixated on Germany. So Germany was pretty much the only option, because the Kaiser, many German soldiers, officers, and politicians did not want the Ottoman Empire as an ally either. They basically saw the Ottoman Empire as a liability. I mean, but the Kaiser Wilhelm was pretty much in favor. I mean, some other statements as well, was pretty much in favor of that alliance. And as a result, they were accepted into the alliance. If I may, again, I can recommend a great book about this, specifically searching answers for these questions by my colleague and dear friend, Mustafa Aksakal, of Georgetown University, the Ottoman Road to War, the Ottoman Road to World War One, something like that, published by Cambridge University Press in 2008, I would say. It's a great discussion of the Ottomans' many trials and attempts to find an ally for themselves and why they ended up with Germany.
And the last question we're going to ask in on the recorded section that we have here is, actually we kind of started off with the beginning of World War One, and this question kind of ends, is a little bit of an ending question to these wars. This one comes to us from Facebook Live. How did Turkey's post-war treaty experience in the 1920s affect its decision not to participate in World War II?
Well, that's a good question. That's a good question, and which deserves itself its own research. So we talk about this a little, you know, unorganizedly. So the a clear answer, in my opinion, about this question is because the leaders, the Republican leaders, the leaders who established the Turkish Republic, including Mustafa Kemal himself, and his close collaborators, which continue after his death, which constitute the leadership of Turkey, knew by their own experiences how bad a war is, how deadly a war is, all of them were soldiers, not fake soldiers, not someone who, you know, who tried to escape, you know, who glorified war or something like that. They were, you know, blood and flesh, real soldiers who fought many years in battlefields, in different wars, and they knew what war meant. I guess that was the first important factor that motivated them to stay out of another big conflict like World War II. İnönü, you know, I saw the Iron Hand of İsmet İnönü, was the president at the time. He worked tirelessly to keep Turkey out of World War II because he himself was a decorated veteran of Balkan Wars, World War I, War of Independence. These people knew what war could mean for an underdeveloped country. So famously, during one of his, of course, you know, Turkey stayed out of the war in World War II, but suffered a lot because, you know, it had to keep, you know, more than 4 million people under arms at any time. So that was extracting these millions of men out of economy and feeding them. So there's an extra burden upon population, on for population. So during, you know, let me conclude with that, you know, funny anecdote. During one of his, you know, country trips, a small girl, very angry at him apparently, shouted at him, "Because of you, I cannot eat sugar." So İnönü is a smart, you know, showing his smartness, all, you know, from very early on as a smart and keen politician. Well, you cannot eat sugar, but your father is still alive. So that's basically what he meant, what he understood from war. So basically, not these treaties, not the political aspects, if you ask my opinion, that of course had their impact on, but you know, the political context has changed dramatically. But the real experience, wartime experiences, kept them very consciously out of war, or, you know, they did everything in their capacity to keep the country out of the war. So
the two other books that you mentioned, it was Mustafa Aksakal's book, The Ottoman Road to War in 1914 from Cambridge University Press. Yes. And I believe Larry Wolf, Woodrow Wilson and the Reimagining of Eastern Europe, if exactly. That is correct. From Stanford University Press. And we would, if you want to follow up more on this conversation, we absolutely suggest that you go take a look at When the War Came Home, The Ottomans Great War and the Devastation of an Empire by our speaker this evening. And it is a privilege and a pleasure to see your face again, Dr. Yiğit Akin. If you enjoyed this, we highly suggest that you do take a look at his other lecture on our YouTube channel. Easiest to get there from www.theworldwar.org. It's up in the upper right hand corner in the YouTube section. We would also invite you to join us back on Zoom again Tuesday. That's tomorrow at 3 p.m. when we take a look at how World War I changed us, and specifically looking at influenza and the Alaskan Dena Nina population, featuring Aaron Liggett at the Anchorage Museum, who is going to absolutely pronounce it correctly. It is a long day here. And on Thursday at 3 p.m., The Enduring Legacy of World War I on the Middle East Today with Dr. Lisa Oddley. There are going to be a lot of teaching resources that you can use on site or online. So join us there as well. If you are open, we might answer a couple more questions afterward. But ladies and gentlemen, if you are joining us on Facebook Live, if you're joining us on Zoom, thank you so much for being here, Dr. Akin. Thank you.
I would still love to hear your favorite barbecue joints in Kansas City.
Right. My neighborhood barbecue joint is the original Joe's Kansas City, right over in the gas station. So highly suggest that. And from our Zoom, LC's, you shouldn't miss it.
Yeah. I would love to try LC's.
Right. Oh, yeah. Oh, it's... You're not going to go wrong with barbecue in Kansas City. All of you, please join us in KC. It's a great place to be, and we hope that wherever you are this evening, you have a lovely and peaceful evening. Have a good night.
Take care.